start thanking the organizers and especially Jeff for inviting me here. So I look forward to sharing thoughts with you. So this is an overview of issues, and I will not just be talking about happiness as you perhaps think it is. I will enlarge a little bit the topic to talk about well-being approaches so that you can see where what people consider to be happiness proper fits in the broader picture. One key issue that I should mention in the beginning is that I will not be talking about well-being as a sort of objective thing that we would like to analyze with a completely neutral approach. I'm more interested in well-being insofar as it can be useful for social evaluation, for public policy design, and that I hope fits well with the purpose of this day, which is about improving society and giving hope to people. So a very rough outline of my talk. I will present several approaches, six or seven, you'll see perhaps even eight, but you'll see why I hesitate a little bit. Then I will review some conceptual issues about these approaches. And finally, if I have the time, it will be a bit shorter, but I will discuss measurement issues and where we should seek improvement in getting more data or better data. Okay, so let's start with the six, seven, eight approaches. So let me start with the really basic thing. So a lot is being done just looking at people's income in analyzing society. And when you look at individual data or household data, there are issues about exactly what you should be considering, right? So it could be gross income, it could be net income, it could be something closer to the level of consumption, so what economists call expenditure. And sometimes also people look at wealth, which is interesting because it gives an idea of people's perspectives over time, right, over the future and their degree of security in their life. When you move to the social level, then I'm sure you've all heard about GDP. That's a sort of salient measure that many people use. And the poor Simon Kuznets, who is one of the pioneers, the founders of this notion, created really the method to measure it, must have felt miserable because he was very adamant that it should not be used to measure social welfare, that it was just a measure of the capacity of production, how the productive system was doing. And his warnings have not been listened to very much, right? And so GDP has become, and still is for most policymakers, the indicator of how well society is going. Even though, of course, many people have criticized, and I wanted to show this. I mean, there is a famous talk given by a politician in 68 against the GDP. It's a long thing, you can find it on the internet. I was just curious to see if the young people in the audience know who that politician is.
Is that Robert Kennedy?
Yeah, exactly, bravo. Yeah. And so to give you an idea of perspective, I think the GDP, I will be very critical, of course, about GDP and this sort of thing, but it still gives an interesting sense of perspective. So here is a very simple graph of GDP of various countries. So you have the US at the top, Europe, and so on. And we are now around here, right? And so we see that there are countries which are way below the others, but some are seem to be taking off. China and India are taking off. And if we were to, so what follows here is just a projection based on the last decade growth rate. And actually for China, I have reduced that a little bit because nobody believes that it will continue at the same pace as it has in the past decade. But even though you see that China would really catch up if it continued like that, even at a slower pace, it would catch up dramatically. But why I wanted to show this graph is that you should really be worried about one thing, which is this curve here. This curve is really problematic because we are facing, in the coming decade, we'll be facing a very, very problematic situation with Africa if things don't change seriously, right? So that's something that is important to bear in mind. Okay, now, second approach. Something that sometimes we call composite indicators, and Martin Rabelian is very critical about this approach. He calls that mishmash indicators. And the idea is, you first define indicators by domain. So income can be a domain, and then another domain can be health, another domain can be education, and so on. And then you aggregate these domain indicators with some weights, right? And then the difficulty is what kind of weight should you be using for that? So there is a very famous example of such a mishmash indicator. That's the Human Development Index, which proceeds in the following way. So you have three dimensions: GDP, longevity, and education. There is an education score, which is a mixture of various things. And what it does is that it first normalizes each of these dimensions between 0 and 1. And roughly 0 is the lowest level that you observe in the sample, and 1 is the highest level. And then it takes the mean of these three things, right? And so that gives you, again, this is sort of graph that gives you a perspective of how countries of different groups have been doing. You see that unlike the GDP, this graph is bounded by 1. Okay, it's impossible for anybody to go beyond 1 given the construction. But we don't see a very clear convergence, right? So there is the pace of convergence is not so quick, and we can be again a bit worried about that. So I'll talk more about the conceptual issues later. But you see, people can be very critical about these sort of indicators, GDP and these composite indicators. Nevertheless, they give you some picture of what's going on. In various countries. This is another graph that shows the relation between GDP and the Human Development Index. So you see you have this kind of curve like that, which is quite typical of many indicators. Okay, the third approach is the capabilities approach, which was initiated by Amartya Sen and Martha Nussbaum. And the capability approach refers to a capability set, which is essentially something like that, where you have available options in multiple dimensions, and these multiple dimensions are functionings. What is a functioning? It's anything you can do or be. And I've taken two examples here, which I like, biking and hiking. But of course, it's not just, you have many other things in life. But this is just an example. So a set is, you could choose to be here, you could choose to be here, or you could choose to be here if you want to do something else, right? So that's the kind of conceptual approach. And one difficulty when you introduce this notion is how do you compare sets across people? So sometimes it looks like the comparison is simple. If someone has a set that is everywhere below the set of, or totally included in the set of someone else, it seems easy to say, yeah, this person must be worse off. But if you want to compare this set and this set where you have less in one dimension and more in another dimension, the comparison becomes a bit trickier. Right, so you need to introduce weights between the various dimensions, and again, we have a problem of valuation. So I'll be talking about that a bit more when we go to conceptual issues. Fourth approach, the equivalent income is something that is perhaps a little trickier to explain, but it's actually quite simple. So the idea is to, does that work? Yeah. So the idea is to solve this equation. Okay, so I won't do any math in this talk, but this equation is the following. So you have a function that represents how well off the person is, and it depends on income and other stuff. This other stuff can be health, can be social status, social connections, and so on, many, many things. You imagine that this person could have the same achievements, the same well-being, if this person was actually enjoying a reference value for all the non-income dimensions, and you compute the hypothetical level of income that combined with with this reference quality of life would produce the level of well-being that you are currently observing for this person, right? So why would you like to do this kind of exercise? Well, because if you do that for everyone, you see this equivalent income that you compute for everyone will be something that, if it were combined with a situation in which everyone enjoys the reference quality of life, the reference non-income dimensions, then you would have a situation in which it would be simple to compare people. They would all have the reference quality of life, and they would only differ in income. Okay? And so the comparison between them could just be done in terms of income. So that's the idea that underlies this this approach. And so it was initially introduced by Samuelson and Swami. So Paul Samuelson, I'm sure it's a name that you know well, Subramanian Swami is a controversial character. I wanted to mention that because my Indian colleagues are always appalled when I quote him, but he is one of the founders of this notion because he was co-author of Samuel Sun. You should Google and see what he has become. It's a bit interesting. What they did was the following kind of thing. So if you have some economics background, you'll understand quickly, but the idea is we have a problem of comparing people's living standards when they are facing different crises on the market. For instance, different countries, they have different prices, even different currencies. And how do you compare that? So that's the PPP problem, the purchasing power parity problem. How do you do this kind of comparison? And so their idea was to say, okay, let's imagine that everyone is facing a given set of reference prices. And let's compute the income they would need if facing these reference prices, they achieve their current well-being, right? And so in a way, you are computing a hypothetical situation in which everyone faces the same prices, and the differences between them is only in terms of income. Okay, so that's exactly the equivalent income story. And so the idea of the equivalent, the reference prices is essentially to choose the slope of a budget set, and this is an indifference curve of a person, and you compute where you would have to put the budget set in order for this person to obtain the indifference curve they are at. Okay. Now, this is only about prices and commodities, but you can extend this approach to non-market things, and that's how I introduced it in the beginning here. So you can really think in terms of you have income and quality of life here. So again, this curve represents points that are just indifferent for the person. They give the same level of achievement. The person might be somewhere here, and you ask yourself the question, well, if we were able to put this person at the reference quality of life, what level of income would produce the same level of well-being? Right? So that's the idea. And so this extension to non-market quality of life dimensions was done by was suggested by Peter Hamel, I think, the first to think of it. Okay, so here is an example of a curve again. Different countries over time. This has been done with my co-authors at the OECD. Romina Borini, Fabrice Mertin, and Paul Schreyer. I like to show this graph for two reasons. One is I'm French, and so I have some French pride to show that if you compare the curve for France and the curve for the US, they come very close to one another, unlike the GDP, right? And that's because we correct, so here it's income, corrected for unemployment, corrected for longevity. And the US is not doing that great in terms of longevity. And also corrected for inequality. So we have deducted a sort of premium because of inequality, which is greater in the US. But the other thing that I like in this graph, and more seriously, is when you look at the curve for Spain and for Greece, you see that what happened with the crisis has been absolutely terrible for them. Much more terrible than when you look at the GDP curves. Okay, so that's why it's important to introduce these additional dimensions in the picture. Okay. So now, I hope you are, I'm happy you are still here. I will be talking about happiness proper, right? And so subjective well-being is actually coming in various forms. And psychologists talk about different dimensions of subjective well-being. So the main forms that have become popular in the literature are the hedonic approach, the hedonic type of well-being, which is essentially emotions, feelings, all these things that make you feel okay, feel stressed, feel angry, feel contented, and so on, and that evolve throughout the day. The second form is evaluative well-being. So when you make a judgment, you reflect on your situation, you say, how good is my situation according to my values, according to my goals, and so on. Right? So that's an evaluative approach. And you have a typical way to get this evaluation is by asking people questions about their satisfaction with their life. So the typical question is, how satisfied are you with your life as a whole these days? Right, so you find this kind of question in questionnaires. For the hedonic approach, it's a bit trickier because it's something that evolves throughout the day. And so the kind of question that is asked to people is, can you remember what you've done yesterday at 3 p.m.? And in what state of mind you were at that time, this sort of thing. So there is a bit of a difficulty because people may not remember. So a better method is when people have a buzzer and it buzzes randomly over time, and so then when it buzzes you have to say, oh, what am I doing and how do I feel right now? That is more expensive, it's slightly better. And finally, a third approach, which I will not talk much about because it is a bit closer to the evaluative approach, and we know less about that. It has been introduced a bit more recently. It's the eudaimonic approach, which is less about a global evaluation of the situation, but more focusing on the sense of meaning and purpose that people have in their life. So to give you a few examples of how these things play out, so this is a graph that comes from a previous publication by my colleagues Angus Deaton and Daniel Kahneman, where they have looked at, so the ladder curve here is a curve of an evaluative approach. The ladder is a specific question which tells people, imagine a ladder where 0 means the worst possible life you could have and 10 means the best possible life you could have. Right? So where do you stand? On what rung of the ladder do you stand now? Okay, so that's the ladder of life question. And the other questions are about feeling, right? And so the point of their figure here is, you should come in, Carol. The point of their figures is that you see these emotion curves tend to stall at some point, as if, and here we have income, right, or annual income on the horizontal axis, so as if income beyond a certain point has no longer any impact on your feelings, but it still has an impact on your satisfaction, on your evaluation. Okay. Another well-known kind of example is the different countries. This is GDP per capita, and you have again. You see this kind of curve here. It's a bit more messier than the previous graph, but it's something that shows that there is a broad increasing relation. But there is also a lot of noise vertically, which means that at the same level of income, you find great variations in the level of satisfaction. Another thing that I wanted to show is the famous Easterlin paradox. So I guess many of you have heard about that. What is it? The problem of the Easterlin paradox is that these measures of happiness, and in particular the evaluative measure, are very stable over time. So when you look at long-term data, they are very stable. It's partly due to the very construction of these data. They are bounded data. People answer a question on a bounded scale. So this cannot really blow up over time like GDP, right? But the fact that it looks extremely stable is a bit problematic when you compare with improvements in objective conditions of life. And so that raises interesting questions about whether people's use of the scale shift over time. So we'll be talking about that a little bit. Finally, the last approach I wanted to mention is this idea of using people's Vandermann-Morgenstern utilities, which relax. So these utilities are utility functions that economists use when they want to represent people's attitude to risk. So when you face risk, you have to decide whether the perspective of a gain is less and less important as the gain is higher. And if it is less and less important, somehow this means that you will be reluctant to take gambles because the perspective of high gains will look less impressive than the perspective of large losses. Right? And so if you have a utility function that has this curvature here, you will be what economists call risk averse. And so this concept has been introduced a long time ago by John von Neumann and Oskar Morgenstern. These functions are interesting because they have, the curvature is meaningful, right? So that suggests perhaps we could use that in terms of capturing the notion of diminishing marginal utility, and the fact that being better off and better off becomes less and less important. But there is a problem with these curve, with these utilities, which is that they are not easy to use for interpersonal comparison. So if you want to do social evaluation, how do you compare the utility functions of different people? And so if you look at this function here, so the idea of something I should have said is that this, when you look at a lottery that you are facing, right, an uncertain prospect, what you do with the expected utility approach is that you compute the average value of utility where you look at all possible gains and you weight them by the probabilities of obtaining these gains. Right? So that's the notion of expected value. So it's a sort of average value weighted by probability. And so the problem is that when you have an individual with this curve, imagine the same curve with an increment, just a constant increment. So these two individuals will behave exactly in the same way, but one has a curve that is higher. What does it mean, right? So you see, there is some arbitrariness in the choice of the utility function. If we just observe people's risk attitude, we cannot be sure where to place this function. It could be here, it could be here, we don't know. But that's very important for interpersonal comparisons. Right? And similarly, if we multiply the curve by a positive amount, if we are above zero, then again, it doesn't change the behavior, because twice utility is, if you maximize twice your utility, you have the same behavior as if you maximize one time your utility. And so, again, this is problematic, because if you do that, you change the interpersonal comparison. And so a proposal that has been made and has been revived recently by Matthew Adler, who is in this room, so it's really great to have him here, is to calibrate these utility functions so that we can compare them in a meaningful way. So there are several proposals, and actually Matt has proposed something that is slightly different than that, but this is a sort of salient proposal that we find in the literature. All these people, Kenneth Arrow in particular, has discussed that in his book, have looked at that. The idea of using VNM, Vonnegut-Mongeltschmidt utilities in social evaluation, was pushed by John Arseny, but he never really discussed this particular normalization. I should make it clear that I'm just putting his face here. I show all these faces so that you see that there is a human face behind all these conceptions. So the idea of this normalization is simply to say, okay, we'll identify a point that is pretty bad, and we'll put all the utilities at zero here, and a point that is pretty good, and we'll put all the utilities at one there, right? And once you've done that, then there is no longer any ambiguity. Okay, I finished my first part. Right? So these are the approaches I want to discuss with you. And you see why I hesitate between 6 or 7, because it's for subjective well-being, I'll be making a distinction between hedonic and evaluative approaches, which behave differently and which raise different conceptual issues. Right? So that's why I want to make a distinction between them. Are we all on the same page, or is there any question or objection? No? So let's proceed with conceptual issues. So, I would like to look at these various approaches from the perspective of certain criteria, certain properties, and see if they satisfy them or not. Right? And so I'll be looking at three properties. First is relevance. So they give us a way to make interpersonal comparisons. Do they make it in a way that we feel relevant for social evaluation, for the design of public policy? Right. The second question is about respect in the precise sense of, do they respect the individual themselves in the way they put priorities on various things in their life. Right? So do they capture what matters to people with the ways that people themselves would put on things? And finally, practical thing, data. Are they easy to measure? Are they requesting, are they requiring data that are difficult to use or to collect? So you see, these criteria are very different. So the first one is really, I think, an ethical criteria, right? And there we can disagree. So I'll be making some assertions about that, but we can disagree because different philosophies evaluate social situations in different ways, and that may mean using different measures of well-being. Right? So disagreement is welcome, actually, here, sensible. The issue of respecting preferences, this is more like a sort of factual or logical thing. You look at the measure, you can see if it respects individual values or not. And the final one is more like a pragmatic thing, where we can also disagree because some people are more conservative about using data than others. And so given that we have a lot of young people in the audience, I was thinking perhaps we could build a system of grades that we would assign to the various approaches according to this criteria. So I will focus first in this part on the relevance and the respect criteria, and I will postpone the discussion of data to later in the talk. Okay? Yeah, it should be good. All right, so let's start with incomes, all right, the first row. Income, does it respect people's preferences? So surprisingly, yes, it respects people's preferences to a large extent. If we restrict attention to commodities on the market, goods and services that you can find on the market. Why that? Because if you have greater income, you can do what you want with this greater income. And so having greater income essentially can never harm your priorities. Of course, you may think, oh, but that's a sort of consumerist attitude to life. Some people really hate having more wealth or more money because that destroys a certain form of ethics of life where you should have less resources to be more virtuous. So, okay, I admit that, right? So there is a sort of materialism in the idea that it respects people's values. At least for the people who can always make use of more money, it's good. But I must admit, this is a sort of perhaps narrow view of what life is. But what is obvious is that income neglects the non-market aspects of life, right? So all the non-market quality of life dimensions are just ignored. And people care a lot about that. And in particular, one thing that happiness studies have shown is that people do care a lot about things like social relations, family situation, and so on, right? Things that you don't buy on the market. And so in terms of respect, the grade I propose to make is between B and C, okay? So it's not that bad because for commodities it's pretty good, but it is pretty terrible when you look at other things than commodities. Right? So that's the idea. What about relevance? Well, for reasonable people, not everyone is reasonable in this respect, but for most reasonable people, income just has instrumental value. They are after something else in life than just amassing dollars. But it's a way to obtain many things, right? Including social status, access to social life, and so on, right? So it may be instrumental, but useful for people who have many goals in life. And so we observe that it is very strongly correlated with many dimensions. And in that respect, the difference between poor and rich people, for instance, measured in terms of income, is actually a good proxy for a lot of things that have to do with social status, social power, and so on, and social and quality of life. So it's not that bad. So the relevance of income goes beyond the intrinsic value of income, which is almost nil. Right, that's the point. So even though it's something that by itself should not matter at all, actually it's a good proxy of many other things. So it's quite relevant, that's why I propose to put a B on it. Right. But again, let me insist. Here I think this is something that has to do with logical analysis. Here this is ethical, so we may disagree on that reasonably. Okay. All right, so now let's look at composite indicators. So the way I describe composite indicators, you remember, it was subdomain indicators and then we aggregate that. So by computing subdomain indicators, you actually lose track of the correlation of dimensions between for every individual, right? So the poor people tend to accumulate disadvantages in income, in health, in social status, and so on, right? And so if you have a measure of income, a measure of health, and so you lose these correlations because you don't start from individuals, you just look at the slices by domain. And so that's really losing something that may be very important for people. So even though you may be pretty good by domain to some extent, right, you will not be good in terms of losing this correlation. And the weighting between these dimensions is problematic. And so you have people who work on composite indicators are hesitating. So I've talked about the HDI, which has just this arbitrary equal weights between the three dimensions. Some people, for instance, the OECD lets you choose the weights when you go on their website. You can choose the weight. Right? So there are things like that which are interesting. But still, it's not clear that it gives us an interesting way to think of the weights, because when you ask people for the weights, what you ask them about is essentially their political preferences, right? If I have to give you a weight between income and health, I'd be thinking about, yeah, what's good for society, income and health, how should we allocate priority between health policy and growth? This is the kind of question I'd be asking myself. But this is not quite what we should be after here. We should be after, for an individual, how important is health, his or her health, compared to his or her income? And that's a different question. That is not a political question. It's more a question about what matters to people in their own life. Right? And so, so essentially, it's a mess, to be quick. The notion of weights in the composite indicator approach is a bit messy. And so in terms of respect, again, I would say we are somewhere here. It's not necessarily very bad by domain, but the combination of domains is worse. It's really bad on two counts. First, the weight problem, and second, the lack of correlation, not recalling the correlations. What about relevance? So you can hesitate, but I have the impression we should say it at least as relevant as income, because usually income is a component of it. And so insofar as we have, for instance, the HDI, you have income plus education plus health. Yeah, so you have a lot of good things there. That makes it quite relevant. There is a risk in many of these indicators to neglect inequality. It's not something that is really cast in stone, because you can introduce an inequality index in such an indicator. Many of them don't. The HDI in particular, they have hesitated about how to deal with inequality. So the main methodology has no inequality consideration, and then they have constructed variants where you have some inequality consideration in the thing. So that's, if you just look at average performance per domain, you have no notion of inequality index. So the relevance is, I could be here in a charitable way, because it's at least as good as income, presumably, but yeah, not too excited about it. Okay, what about capabilities? You stop me if I'm too quick, don't hesitate to ask questions if anything is not clear. So remember, it's essentially a set of options where, and you can choose from this set, so it's like a menu. So offering people a menu and reasoning in terms of this menu looks good for the respect of preferences, because people can choose from that menu, right? So it looks like, and actually it's really based on this, it's motivated by that. Really the motivation of Amartya Sen and Martin Azlan is to have freedom being a key component of the analysis. The difficulty is, so the set itself is somehow looks good. But as I said, we have to compare sets which are which overlap in complex ways across people. And so how do you make this comparison? You need some weighting of the various dimensions. And again, we have the problem of the weight. And so what Amartya Sen has been suggesting quite strongly is that we should imagine having a public debate, a sort of community discussion about these weights, where people would seek to find a consensus on the relative weight of the various dimensions of functionings or capability. And his argument is that it's really a discussion of values, and people may have different values, but somehow they must converge. So I must confess I strongly disagree with that. I don't think that the importance, the relative importance, let's take health and income, the relative importance of health and income is something on which I need to agree with my neighbor. I may have my view on how important health is, my neighbor may have a different view, and we should each live our own lives based on these values. There is no need to have a long conversation to make sure we obtain the same weights at the end of the conversation. That seems to me not warranted, and I don't think that this is, this idea that we should have a consensus on the weights is actually so deeply important for the capability approach. So we can very easily imagine a variant of the capability approach where the weights could be individualized, could be personalized. So in terms of respect, it depends a bit on how this issue plays out, but if you stick to the community value approach, you can have a B rather than an A. Now in terms of relevance, the capability approach has been extremely attractive to many people because it is completely flexible. You can choose any functioning you want, and so essentially, whatever approach to life you have, you can somehow fit it in the capabilities approach. And so that makes it extremely flexible and appealing. Of course, the flip side of that is that it is so flexible that and it doesn't provide much guidance to how exactly make the selection. And as I said, this idea of having a community discussion about the weights there is a prior state to that, which is I'm making a selection of the dimensions that will be put on the table for discussion. So it's somehow it's a subset of the discussion of weights, right? Putting a zero weight is like excluding a dimension from the discussion. There is no clear guidance. So the approach is very flexible, but more would need to be said about that. So I put V here as relevant again because it's very flexible. It can be very relevant, but it can also be very imperfect depending on how the details are filled in. Now, what about equivalent input? So remember, it's really based, I've drawn this in different curves, so it's really based on people's individual preferences, so it can directly reflect these preferences. But nevertheless, there are some difficulties. So in principle, it looks very good, but there are practical difficulties. One difficulty is that not all aspects of people's immediate preferences are respectable. People are sometimes a bit silly, a bit inconsiderate in their preferences. And so there is a lack in people trying to implement this thing. There's total lack of method for making a selection between what's respectable and what's not respectable in people's preferences, right? And we would need something like that. But that's not just for equivalent income. Any method that wants to rely on people's preferences has this problem. And this is an important problem I come back at the end if I have the time. Another difficulty is that estimating people's preferences is practically very hard. And so in practice, most of the methods, such all imperfect as they are, one key imperfection is that they do not track individual variations in preferences. At most, what they do is to track inter-sociodemographic group variation. Right? So you have the preferences of people living in a certain region, a certain gender, age, and so on. So you capture the average preferences of these subgroups, but you don't really capture the individual preferences. Now, some people say, well, perhaps after all, the average preferences by group is somehow that that eliminates some idiosyncrasies that are not so respectable across people. So somehow the group average preferences would be more respectable than the totally individual preferences. I don't know. Probably I have no idea about that. So I put an A here, but it doesn't mean that there are no problems. Right? It's just that the theory looks good, but the practice is a bit messier. What about relevance? So the issue of relevance is ethical, and so we may disagree about it. One thing on which people may object to this approach is that, as I said, right, the approach consists in imagining a world in which everyone is at the reference quality of life, the non-income dimensions, and then people in this hypothetical world only differ in terms of income. And then the ranking that you make across people is in terms of income. So that's a purely objective approach, right, to that extent. So you do take into account preferences in order to construct this hypothetical world. But once you are in a hypothetical world where everybody enjoys the reference quality of life, you are just focusing on income. So that might be something that is controversial, right? Might be considered to be a bit restrictive. Another difficulty is that you have to choose the reference that serves in the construction, right? And so this is contentious. You may disagree on the choice of reference. And let me explain a bit more how that plays out. Choice of the reference will direct you to favor, to put a special concern for the people having certain types of preferences. So let me illustrate that. So this is the same graph as before, right, with quality of life and income. And you see, if I imagine two people who are at this point, for instance, here, one cares a lot about having more of the quality of life. So really, you see this curve here is steep, which means that he's willing to make a big sacrifice on income in order to improve quality of life. Whereas the other guy here is less willing to make such a sacrifice, which means that he cares more about income than about quality of life. And so you see, if we focus, if our social analysis will have a special concern for the worse off in society, the worse off here will be the guy who cares a lot about quality of life. And why is that? Well, because we have chosen the reference quality of life that is high according to the distribution. It's above people's situation. If we had chosen a situation that was below people's situation, we would have the opposite ranking. And so you see that the way in which you will allocate priority to people, depending on their preferences, depends on their choice of reference. And so that's, I hope I'm not losing you here, but that's quite important because it's something that is bound for creating discussions, debates, and disagreement. One thing that people, I'd like to explain that people have hard time to realize often is that it looks very natural to say, at least if someone has more in all dimensions, it should be considered to be better off. But that's not true if you want to take into account preferences, because there is an additional consideration, which is how the preferences fit with the situation that people enjoy. And so here you have two people who are at the same point, that there's a same income, same quality of life. That doesn't mean they are equally well off, because they have different preferences. And so their situation has a different fit with their preferences. So this idea of dominance, right? So if someone has more in all dimensions than someone else, that should be treated considered better off. This is very appealing, but it's just deceptive. It shouldn't be appealing, because it forgets about preferences and the fit with preferences. Okay? So in the equivalent income approach, we do satisfy dominance, but only in a limited sense, and in particular only for the people who have the reference quality of life, because then more income means you are better off. All right. So given all this, another consideration is that very often, I've been working on this approach, and very often I meet the following depressing objection: oh, it's too complex for lay people. So very nice in theory, but nobody would understand that. So there might be some truth to it, but I don't think it's a correct objection, because I talked about GDP, and nobody asked, what is GDP exactly? But I'm sure if I were to ask around, it would be very hard to find someone who is able to define GDP. Right? So I don't believe that this is really such an objection, but still, it's an important consideration sometimes in communication. So I don't know where to put the relevance here, depending on how you consider these difficulties, it may be made of it. Okay, now, happiness proper. So the hedonic approach to subjective well-being, what about respect? And so here, I have some hedonist friends, especially among philosophers, and I always quarrel with them, because I tell them, you are paternalistic. You pretend that you know what's good for people, is to have good mental state, good feelings, and so on. But not everybody is like that. Some people believe about other things than just having a good mental state. And so pure hedonists are not respectful of people's preferences. If you really want to focus on mental state, it's not totally respectful. I wanted to mention there is an unpublished paper by Mayne Skimble and Chris, which is interesting, because they say we could use variation in happiness to track people's preferences. Because if something good happens to you, we should observe that your mental states will improve, right? Because it's a good news. When you receive good news, it improves your mental. If you receive bad news, it decreases your mental state. And so we could use mental states in this way as a proxy in the variations and a proxy for preferences. So it could be used to estimate preferences. But they don't propose to use it as a metric for comparing people. That's a totally different issue. Right? So, and I wanted to really insist on that. A measure of subjective well-being could be totally useless in terms of comparing people, but could still be very useful for other purposes, like estimating preferences. And that's very important. Right? So we should always consider that different uses can be made of the same kind of data. And so in terms of respect, I would say the hedonic approach is not good. Not very good. What about relevance? Well, relevance is perhaps even worse, because there is something called the hedonic treadmill, which is that we are wired in a nice way, which is that whatever happens, our mental state tends to come back to a certain level of stress and contentment that is more attuned to our personality traits than to anything else. Right? You have people living in war situations, and their mental state is still about the same as it used to be before the war and this sort of thing. Right? So it's very good in a way for human beings to be in this way. That's great. But it's very bad if you want to use this measure to evaluate people's situation. Because if it's too stable, then it tracks nothing. Right? So that's something that is of course, the true hedonists, they don't worry about that. They say, well, it's good. It means that people can somehow save their mental health and their mental state. And so we should really focus about that. And if they can live under duress and still be okay, that's good. And let's try to find ways to limit the consequences of duress and so on. So that's one attitude, right? But again, this is only if you really believe in hedonism. Okay, so now let's look at the evaluative approach, which is more really attuned to people's perspective on life, what matters to them really. And so here you have a priori a good thing, because people can put, when you ask the question, how satisfied are you with your life as a whole these days? Well, you can put whatever you want in that part. So you can even put as much weight you want on whatever you care a lot about. So that's, that looks very good. One difficulty is that when you want to use these measures for interpersonal comparisons, it might happen that different people use the scale in different ways, right? And so a scale from 0 to 10, a 7 for one person might mean the same thing as a 6 for another person. And so how do you do the comparison, right? So here is an example of the kind of problem that you may have. So here are in different scales. So the dimensions are dimensions of life, anything you might want to make. And so you may have a person, Anne, who is better off in terms of satisfaction because the indifference scale is everywhere above that of Bob. But when asked the question about satisfaction, this person, Anne, may say 7 and Bob may say 8, right? So the score seems higher for Bob. And that's a phenomenon that was very well captured by Carroll's notion of happy peasants and miserable millionaires, right? You can have this sort of re-ranking of things which are problematic for interpersonal comparison. And so in terms of respect, surprisingly, it is not so good, right? So that's surprising because it allows people to put whatever they want in the answer. The problem is the comparisons across people may be disrupted by this use of scale. And so that's something I'd like you to understand, which is that respecting people's preferences is not just about their personal preferences over their own situation. It's also something that has to do with interpersonal comparisons. So when people have the same preferences, you may want to also respect their interpersonal comparisons because they are based on the same preferences. So if you have a group of people say, we all have the same preferences, we rank our lives in this way, how would you come and say, no, I disagree with you. I consider that actually this person is better off. And so, right, that would be bizarre. That would be disrespectful. And so that's why I put a B here instead of an A. In terms of relevance, it seems more relevant than hedonic subjective well-being. And in particular, as I've shown in the beginning with the relation with income, the evaluative scores relate more clearly to objective conditions of people. And so, for instance, Daniel Kahneman hesitated throughout his intellectual career about whether we should focus on mental states or on evaluative conditions. He was attracted to mental states because they are somehow more objective to measure, because you can find neurological or chemical measures of these things, right? And you cannot do that with evaluative states. But after seeing that evaluative states track objective conditions better, he changed his mind and said perhaps evaluative states are more relevant, actually. So that's something that makes it more relevant. One issue, though, that is problematic is the fact that when you compare the ranking of people in satisfaction scores with other approaches, it seems to be an outlier. And here I'd like to refer to a study that has been made in the handbook on well-being and public policy that Matt and I co-edited by Kunderkamp and Dirk Neumann. They have looked at satisfaction, how people are ranked in satisfaction compared to how they are ranked for other approaches. So you have satisfaction here and here. Income is, you see, so you have people everywhere, essentially, which means that the correlation is not that strong. You have the correlation here. So that's the rank correlation, 25%. The composite indicator here is not the same as what I call composite indicator. It's something that actually starts from individual situations, does the aggregation at the individual level with some objective weight, and then aggregates. So it does capture correlation. So it's a bit better than what I presented here. But still, again, you have something that's not too good. And here you have satisfaction and equivalent income, again, not too good. Satisfaction and BNM utility, again, not too good. But when you look at all the others, you have good correlations, which means that somehow, even though they track people's preferences and so on in very different ways, and composite indicators don't track people's preferences, still, we see a much greater, so this is composite indicator and equivalent income, and so you see much greater correlation. So the two outliers in this analysis are income alone, because it neglects the other dimensions, so it's not very well correlated, and satisfaction. Why satisfaction? Because satisfaction has this happy peasant, miserable millionaire syndrome, that people are re-ranked in ways that seem to be totally arbitrary. All right, So in terms of relevance, you see, the difficulty is because of this thing, it's not too not too good. All right, so now let me talk about VNM utility, and now it's a bit scary because Matt is in the room, but let me try. So the idea of respect here, in terms of respect, it looks pretty good because, the VNM utility captures people's, it's a utility function, so it represents people's preferences and so on, right? That looks appealing. One difficulty is about interpersonal comparison. So if we want to extend this notion of respect to interpersonal comparison, then we may have the problem that the calibration of the scaling of this utility function may generate re-rankings, which are a bit like what we've seen before. So we may have a situation in which we have these two guys with Anne as obviously a better situation, but may turn out to have a lower VNM utility after rescaling. Why not? Well, because we may have such a situation, okay? So we may have a situation where Anne is better off than Bob, but because they have different risk attitudes, Bob ends up having a higher VNM utility than Anne, right? So the use of these VNM utility functions introduces something that may produce such reversal, okay? And so you could ask, perhaps it's just because of this particular scaling of the VNM function. Well, actually, no. As soon as you have different risk attitudes, whatever scaling you use, the VNM functions will cross at some point, and as soon as you have crossings, you will have this potential problem. So that's so in terms of respect, it's not as good as it could be, provided you extend this issue of respect to interpersonal comparison. In terms of relevance, I would say it's pretty good because it captures a lot in people's life. Moreover, it captures risk attitudes, which may be quite relevant, right? So up to now, I didn't talk about risk attitudes, and in most applications, risk attitudes are ignored, and of the other approaches, risk attitudes are ignored. So it's true that for a lot of public policies, risk attitudes are not so important because we actually know what will happen to people statistically. So it may be that every individual bears a lot of risk, right? You don't know, especially young people here, you don't know what job you will have, what income you will have, what health you will have throughout life. But the statistician knows what the distribution will be, perhaps not this in this room because the room is small, we don't have many people, but of a large numbers, we somehow know exactly more or less what will happen to the population. And so, in a way, we already know the final state, even though we don't know at the individual level. But there are situations which are really risky for society. So climate change, for instance, financial instability, a lot of things can create big risk, and so it is important to make kind of risk attitudes there. And so the VNM utilities have to be introduced somewhere. So that's something that is important to bear in mind. So here is a summary of the grading, okay? If we want to, so it's tricky to make because there is no clear domination between some of them, but if you want to look for domination, so it looks like equivalent income according to my criteria is good. And then we have the VNM utility approach, which is almost as good. And then we have the capabilities approach. And then we have a sort of tie between income composite indicators and the evaluative subjective well-being. And finally, we have the hedonic approach. Again, let me insist. I don't want to impose that on you. This column here is really a column that is ripe for disagreement, right? It's really an ethical column. You may have different views, and I would accept that. Now, what about data? So do I have a few minutes left, yes. Jeff? Yeah?
Yes, we're going to end at 11, so we want to leave a little time for questions.
Exactly. So, it's 5 minutes or so?
Yeah.
Good. So let me go quick about that because it's somehow more down to earth, but it's nevertheless important if you want to think of application. So if you think of income is pretty good I've messed up the rankings here, but the income is pretty good because a lot of work has been done on that, but still I want to warn you that there are problems, and actually statisticians are really worried about the inconsistency between various data sources, so there is still a lot of work to be done. So in particular, the problem of comparison across countries is still very hard to do. There is the issue that many data come in household, where the units are household, but we would like to track things at the individual level. That's a problem. And there is a discrepancy between data coming from national accounts and data coming from individual surveys. And so on. So there is a Thomas Piketty and his group have been working on building a new database that somehow explains this discrepancy. And that's a great service to the community, really, to show where the difference comes from. And now they are doing country after country. It's a lot of work, it's very hard. They've done it for the US and France, I think, already. But it really explains why we find such discrepancies in the data. Okay, composite indicators are a bit harder because you need to have statistics on additional dimensions, right? Capabilities, so the problem with capabilities, when I put a grade here, it just means how easy it is to get these things, right? So I don't mean it's bad, it's just that it's hard. And so capabilities, it's harder because you want to really track the correlation of across dimensions for people, right? And for that, you need to have one single survey in which every unit, individual or household, is asked about all the dimensions at the same time. If you have a separate survey for health and a separate survey for income and so on, you are not able to track this correlation. So you need a single survey, and that's something that is a bit more difficult. And then you have the VNM utility and the equivalent income, which are pretty bad because they rely on estimations of preferences. And that's really very hard. So there is no good method. People disagree about how good or bad the methods are. There are various ways to do that. We can talk about it later. I won't go into the details, but this is still very much research, open to research. And finally, I would say the subjective well-being data are very good because they are very cheap to acquire. Just one questionnaire. It's very cheap to ask the question, how satisfied are you with your life as a whole these days? It takes a people. The average time of answer for this question, right, people, right, they think very hard about their life, is around 10, 12 seconds. So it's extremely cheap. Of course, there are some problems for, as I said, for the hedonic thing, recall is a problem. People may have bad memory. And for the evaluative thing, people may be framed sometimes, I think you wouldn't expect. So depends on where the question is in the questionnaire. So if the question comes after, for instance, in the US, if it comes after, what do you think of the situation in Washington? And that was, I mean, before the last election. people are depressed, and that reduces their satisfaction with their own life by 1 point, okay? Just because they have thought of Washington before answering the question. So that's something that's problematic. So we have to be careful about this. All right, so now concluding. If we want to restrict attention only to things that are easy to access in terms of data, I would say we have the choice between income, things like the HDI, Human Development Index, and satisfaction with life. If we want to allow for capability for additional data, a single survey on all the dimensions, then capabilities are the best approach according to my ranking. So what I'm doing now is I select among the subset of things which are not too hard to get, what is the best according to my ranking here. So capabilities would be the best. And finally, if we allow for all sorts of data, equivalent income would be the best, and VNM utility would be just behind. So that's the idea. So suggested take-home messages, something like that, right? So first point, ethical considerations are important. It's not just a factual discussion of what well-being is. It's what kind of comparison we want to make. Objective, subjective, there are degrees of subjectivity, right? So if you think of VNM utility, it's more subjective than income, but it's less subjective than satisfaction with life, in a way, right? So you have degrees of subjectivity, same for equivalent income. The other thing I'd like you to remember is that respecting people's assessment of their life is demanding, and in particular, it is something that may bear not just on intrapersonal comparison, but also on interpersonal comparison. And finally, something that should be obvious, but is worth saying perhaps, when people care about objective achievements in their life, purely subjective measures somehow are a non-starter, and we should know it right from the beginning, right? So that's something that is, okay. And so in terms of questions that research would be useful, apart from getting better data and so on, there is this issue of respecting preferences. In my list, only one approach, the equivalent income, respects preferences over interpersonal comparisons and not just intrapersonal comparison. But you shouldn't believe that this is the only approach that does it. There are hundreds of other possible approaches, and we need more research on that. Right? So it's just an example. There are other approaches that can do it. And the one question that people often ask is, can one imagine cleaning the evaluated the satisfaction with live data from heterogeneous KUs? So we'll talk about that, I guess, later, perhaps in the panel. One interesting issue is that this question perhaps is not meaningful, as stated, because it makes sense when people have the same preferences in life. But when they have different preferences, the question is not directly meaningful, because we cannot know what it means to clean things when the direction of people's is different. And finally, as I already mentioned, how to define and how to elicit estimate respectable preferences, very much a blank page so far. All right, thanks a lot.